click the bell icon to get latest videos from Ekeeda.
Hello friends, in the previous lecture we have got to know about what is Sp3d hybridization, and now we are going to talk about Sp3d2 hybridization. So now let us talk about the examples in this lecture, that which of the molecules that are exhibiting this kind of hybridization, and what are the orientation, how they are been formed, on this kind of bonds are been formed, or like symmetry orientation. Let us talk about this in this lecture. So basically we are talking about sp3d2 hybridization. So the definition is very easy to understand, similarly that we have did in the previous lecture, that is the process of mixing and recasting of 1s 3p and 2d orbitals of the same atom with nearly equal energy to form 6 hybrid orbitals having the equivalent energy, maximum symmetry, as well as definite orientation in space. They are basically, this kind of process of mixing and recasting is basically known as sp3d2 hybridization. So now let us talk about the example, and let us see that which of the molecules that show this kind of hybridization, and let us see how the bonds are being formed. So talking about the example, that is, or you could say that is the formation of sulfur hexafluoride. So this is what we are going to talk about. And talking about the sulfur, actually the sulfur is present in the middle of, or we could say that it is the central atom of the whole molecule, and that is the reason that it will be exhibiting the atomic orbitals that are involved in that of hybridization, and that is what I am going to talk about. So talking about the sulfurs, that is the atomic number, so sulfur's atomic number is basically 16, so I could write it in this way, that is sulfur 16, and the electronic configuration that could be written as 1s2, 2s2, 2p6, 3s2, 3p4. So if you count this one, then this is basically 16 electrons that are present over here. But now actually we are concerned with that of the outermost shell, and this outermost shell is what we are going to concern it with this one. And now let us understand that how can we mention about the orbitals that are present over here. So for that, suppose this s orbital is present over here, so I will make a box over here like this, represent the orbital that we know already. And this piece, the subshell, actually it consists of 3 orbitals, so that is what I'm mentioning over here. So there are 3 orbitals over here, that is one is px, one is py, and then one is pz orbitals, and let us now fulfill the electrons. So talking about the fulfilling of electrons, this s has basically 2 electrons over here, so 2 electrons are over here, so I will write it as s. And here on the p subshell there are basically 4 electrons, and we will follow the Hund's rule and while filling the electrons, that is 1, 2, 3, and 4. So 4 electrons are present over here, as we could see over. But the sulfur is the one that has been it is forming, obviously whenever it is forming a bond with that of fluorine, and fluorine is the one that cannot form double bond, or that cannot form multiple bond. It is the fluorine is the one that will form only a single bond with any of the atom through which it has been attached through. And that is the reason that if we see the valence electrons, so or the unpaired electrons, so there are 2. So sulfur don't combine with that of 2 fluorine, so as to form SF2, because we are talking about a formation of SF6. So that's the reason something has to be done, so that we could get vacant or we could get basically unpaired electrons, so that they could be able to form the bond with that of the fluorine atoms, or the any atom that has been combining with that of the central atom, that is sulfur. So this is the thing that we have mentioned over here, is basically ground state one. So obviously we have to excite it. So to basically excite the electrons, we should make sure that it should have actually empty orbitals. So we could write the electronic configuration of the sulfur as this way also, that is the similarly the way that we did in the previous lecture, and this is basically, I could write it as 3d0. So now I have basically vacant d orbitals, and on them I could shift the electrons. So let us see that how can we shift the electrons. So talking about the another one, that is what I'm going to do is I'm exciting the electrons. So this is the excited state that I'm talking about, and where I could see that s has basically 2 electrons over here, but now I'm going to excite it actually. So therefore this is the thing that we have. And talking about the px, py, pz, this is the p orbital that we have. And talking about the d orbital, even the d orbit, or d subshell consists of basically 5 orbitals, and that are named as dxy, dyz, dxz, dxy minus y square, and d that is z square. So this is what we have. But just for a while, let us do one thing, that is we'll excite the electrons. So suppose if I excite this electron So again, it will not come to that is p orbital or p subshell. Obviously, it will move toward the empty orbital, and that is basically d. So one of the electrons that will shift over the d orbital over here. So now here the thing that has been left is one electron over here, and the rest of these two will be remain as it is. But in this case, basically what we have got is 1, 2, 3, 4 unpaired electrons. So that's the reason we need actually 6 unpaired electrons. So this is the electron that we have in a couple ways. So obviously we will try to, again, we'll excite this thing and we'll shift one of the electron to the empty d orbital. So let this electron will be as it is, and we are shifting this electron to the empty d orbital, and that is this one. So what do we have? We have actually 1s3p, let me name it as px, py, and pz orbital. And okay, but this electron that is present in the d, that is d subshell, so I will name it as like dxy, and this one as dyz. So this basically, we have basically 5 unpaired electrons, or we could say we have 5 orbitals in which at least there is one electron. And now this are being very much responsible so as to form that is bond with the 6 fluorine atoms, and that is what we are going to talk about, the mixing of the orbitals. So what we are going to do is, these are the electrons or these are the orbitals that we have got, and the thing that we have to do the next is we have to mix it. So let me mix it, and let me show that how can we do that. So in this case, basically we have got to know that there is 1s orbital has been involved, and this is what we are talking about mixing. So I will write it over here as mixing of the atomic orbitals. So it consists of 1 s orbital and 3 p orbitals. So that is what I am trying to mention over here, 3 p orbitals. And basically 2 d orbitals. So this is what we have. And now let us fulfill the electrons over here, and that is 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. So this is what we have got, and this is what we have did. We have mixed up the atomic orbitals that we had, and we are doing now basically sp3d2 hybridization. So after the mixing of this orbitals, basically they will form a new pair of orbitals, and that we know as hybrid orbitals or hybrid atomic orbitals. So now let us understand the shape of it, and that we will be able to understand that what we are doing actually. So let us understand in this way, that is since we have involved that is 1 s orbital, so the s orbital will have basically the spherical shape. So this is the shape of the s orbital, plus that of the px, py, and pz, even they are being involved in this case. So therefore, again, the same thing that we are going to do is, suppose if this is the px involved, so therefore I will name it as px plus py orbital is being also involved. So this is py plus pz orbital. So this is what I have mentioned over here as pz orbital, plus one of that is the orbital that is dxy and dyz. So let me explain it here. So this is x axis while this is y axis, suppose, and we are talking about that is there will be that is the orbitals will be between these two, so the shape of which it is basically like this one. So this is what I am talking about, like dxy. And now let us talk about the structure of that is dyz. So since it is dyz, so therefore if I'm talking about the shape of it, then it will be between that is y and z. Suppose if this is y and this is, suppose if it is z axis, then it will be between these two, and this is what we have will got get actually. So this is one of the orbital, while this is another orbital that we have got over here. So this is, I would name it as dyz. So these are the shape of the that is orbitals that we have, and what we have to do is we have to mix each other, mix this one, and what will happen, a new kind of orbitals will be generated, and that are known as hybrid orbitals. So that is what I am going to make the shape of it, and let us see. So in this case, we will get to know that is the shape of the that is sp3d2 orbital is basically square planar bipyramidal. This is how I am going to talk about. So basically there are the 4 orbitals that are present on the same axis. Suppose if this is the thing that I am mentioning over here, so they are present in the same axis, and talking about the rest of the two. So the rest of the two will be above the plane. So one of the orbital will be above the plane over here, and the next orbit will be above the plane over here. So this blue line that I have, or blue orbitals that I have mentioned over here, actually they are present in the plane. and they are distributed in such a way that there will be no repulsion or there will be minimum repulsion, and they have distributed themselves in that way. And talking about this orbitals, that is the one which I have mentioned in the green one, so they are above the plane. So basically this is similar that what we have did in the previous lecture, that is during the bond formation or during the study of sp3d hybridization. And this is the blue one that we have, and that is on the plane. While talking about the green one, it is above the plane over here. So making this, suppose if I join this one, if I join this orbitals, okay, so what I'll get is a square planar. I will get the structure of this one is square, while that of the above one is basically perpendicular to the plane. And if I join this with the axis over here, or with every atom that has been present over here, so therefore we'll get a pyramidal shape. So basically the structure is basically what we could get as a square bipyramidal. But let us understand that how can we draw the structure of it. So this is the thing that we have got to know about the sulfur atom, and every orbital that we are observing here is basically sp3d2 hybrid orbitals of the sulfur. And now this is the thing that we have made it, and let us see that what atoms that are going to attach on this one, and that is basically fluorine. So somewhere I'm talking about fluorine over here, and fluorine is the one which has an atomic number of 9. So I could represent the electronic configuration this way, that is 1s2, 2s2, here it is supposed to be 5, that is what I'm talking about. So this is the outermost orbit that I'm talking about, outermost shell that I'm talking about, and it consists of, that is one subshell, that is S and P subshell. But meanwhile P consists of 3 orbitals that we know, and let us fulfill it with electrons. So therefore this is 2 electrons that we have, this is 1. 2, 3, 4, 5 electrons. But in this case, the last orbit, if you observe, or the last orbital, if you observe, this is PZ orbital. The shape of PZ orbital, suppose if this is the Z axis, I'm talking about like this one. So this will be the shape of it, like this one. And this PZ orbital consists of, that is, one electron. And now there are, we see, this is what we have talked about, fluorine atom. So this kind of fluorine atom, there are 6 fluorine atoms that would be able to join with that of that is sulfur or sulfur hybrid orbitals. So let us do it, that what would be the shape of this one. So this is what we have mentioned over here, and this was talking, I was talking about, that is sulfur. But meanwhile this is fluorine's, that is PZ orbit. Similarly it will join with every of the sulfur one. So we will get like this thing, PZ of fluorine. Again here will be, that is PZ of fluorine atom. And everywhere, suppose if I want to showcase that the overlapping has happened, so it will happen in this way. And here also it will be the same thing, that is, it is of PZ orbital of fluorine. And here also I would mention it here, that is PZ orbital of fluorine. So this is what we have observed over here. And now let us talk about the electrons. Obviously that is one of the hybrid orbitals. Obviously that is one of the hybrid orbitals of that is sulfur, which consists of one electron, while that of fluorine also consists of one electron, that is, which is unpaired. So now here the bonding has started, and this bond will be formed, and this is basically the sigma bond that will be formed, because here, as you could see, that the coaxial overlapping of the orbitals takes place between a hybrid orbital, that is sp3d2 hybrid orbital, and one of the pz orbital of fluorine. So this kind of overlapping has created a sigma bond over here. So similarly, every way or everywhere we could see that the bond has been formed is basically the sigma bond that we could see, and here also. So this is it, and almost we are done with it. But let me give a short idea that how the structure looks like. So this is what I want to explain, and that is sulfur, which is present in the middle or the central one, and it consisted of basically fluorines, 4 fluorines over here, as you would see, on the same plane. Okay, and meanwhile talking about the next fluorine, that fluorine is basically present above and below the plane. So if I join this 2 out of this 4, suppose, so this is the square planar that we have got. But if we join this one with everything, basically we'll get a pyramid above also and basically below also, making this structure to be called, having geometry like square planar bipyramidal. That is what I was talking about. And now let's talk about the bond angle. It is very simple to understand that. Suppose if a square forms and we make a diagonal to that, and if we measure the bond angle, then obviously we'll get to know that this is 90 degree. That is the bond angle between fluorine, sulfur and fluorine. It will be 90. With that of everyone, it will be 90. And that's the reason that the plane will have an around 360 angle. I hope you understood. And talking about the planes that are, or talking about the fluorine, that is the above the plane and below the plane, obviously they will also make a bond angle of 90 degree with that of the plane in which four fluorines are present. So therefore the bond angle, every bond angle here will be basically, we could call it as 90 degree. And that's it. That is what I want to talk about. So this was an example of the Sp3d2 hybridized SF6. So thank you friends for watching this video. I hope you have understood this video very clearly and you have got to know the various concepts behind this. And I hope you'll share this video with friends, and don't forget to subscribe to Ekeeda channel. Thank you so much.